Yeah, as you guys know, the last several times that we've had the meeting here at my house, I've always tried to feature live music. I've had brass quintets, I've had string quartets, I've had singers, I've had all kinds of things. And I was trying to figure out what to have for my next meeting, and I was thinking in terms of having a percussionist, actually, and then it occurred to me that to really have a percussionist, we would sort of need a moving van to bring all of his equipment, so that didn't seem particularly practical. And then, all of a sudden, I got involved in a performance of the Maurer Second at the university, and I made the acquaintance of a world-class symphony conductor. And I said, wow, maybe I could have Maestro Kiesler come and talk to us. So I very gingerly approached him, and he responded with great enthusiasm. And so I'd like to introduce, by the way, how many of you guys were at the Muller Second concert? Okay, a good bunch of you. And there's several others who were there who aren't here right now. Great. So I'd like to introduce Maestro Ken Kiesler. Please. The real question was, what should he talk to us about? And I said, I think we'd be interested in almost anything he had to say. And he said, well, why don't we do it in an interview question and answer format? And I said, fair enough. So I invented some questions, which I will start. Please sit down. I'm going to sit here and you're going to sit there. That's awesome. The light's shining. Okay, and we'll go from there. I've got some musical examples, but let's just start with a question that might be of relevance and interest to our group as well. And the question is, when conducting for the first time in a new hall, new to you anyway, how do you assess the sound of the hall? What factors do you take into consideration? What do you do?
First of all, let me say, having heard now that you've had a brass quintet and a string quartet and singers, you can see how useless we conductors are because I don't make any sound at all. You know, without all of those people, we really can't do what we do. You know, when I walk into a new hall, I do a few things. I might clap my hands and walk around the room a little bit and walk around the stage and sing a few notes. But most importantly, when the orchestra starts to play, it only takes a few seconds to get a handle on the place, to find out how distant things seem, what the bass response is, whether I'm hearing, whether I can hear very well on the stage, whether I can hear past what's in front of me, whether I can hear whether the people on the stage can hear each other. That's obvious right away. If the people on the right aren't playing with the people on the left, usually the problem is they can't hear each other playing. Mm-hmm. And there are a number of other things. You know, when you're a short note, a long note, a loud note, a high note, a low note, after all of this experience that I've had, been doing this for a while, within a few seconds your hands start to react, your ears are reacting, and you're responding to the situation.
Okay. So you come into a hall and you have a feel for how it sounds. What do you do about it?
Well, just about everything we do as a conductor, not everything, but a very high percentage of what we do has to do with acoustics. It has to do with the physics of the performance. It's not, there's the artistic side. What did the composer intend? But mostly we're dealing with several principles that hold true no matter where we are and what we're playing. In every orchestra, everybody who sits farther away from the conductor or near the back plays later than the people who are in the front. Or they play on time, but they sound later. In every orchestra, every long note that goes on of greater duration covers up or drowns out shorter notes or faster notes. These are just some of the examples. There are reasons why the brass sit in the back and the strings sit in front, obviously. We don't put the percussion in front of the strings for obvious reasons. All right. But we're dealing to a great degree, to a large extent, with this long note, short note thing. The people who have longer notes are drowning out the short note people. So we're constantly saying, less of that, more of this. You people need to listen to that. The other thing we're doing is we're giving perspective to the people that we have and they don't have. So, for example, it doesn't, it's not easy for somebody who's sitting in the back to know what's going on in the front. If you're playing a trumpet and you're sitting behind woodwind players, it's very hard to hear what the string players are doing in front. So they might try to watch the bows move, but that doesn't help as much as, or watch the conductor, all right? But the people in front can listen to the people in the back. So we have to give certain perspectives. So you people in the back need to know what's going on. Listen to this. Be aware of this, what's going on there. So I find in rehearsing an orchestra, it's more effective to inform people what's going on somewhere else that they're not aware of, so that they know what the other person is doing and can play with them, than it is to just say, play faster, play slower, play shorter, play longer. So that's your answer.
Well, how do you communicate to them?
Two ways, verbally and with gestures. And the language of gestures is what is the most efficient. It's silent. We can do it while the music's playing. So what I do and what I teach, you know, I have the conducting program, orchestral conducting program at the university. I also teach conducting at the Royal Academy of Music in London and at the National Arts Center in Canada, and I'm the director of the Conducting Academy in Paris. A lot of that work that we do is on that gesture doesn't work because, you know, the players are going to think you mean this, but actually you mean that. So, I mean, what I say to my students is, you know, you have to first have the musical intention. What is it you want to communicate? Then you have to have the ability to communicate it. And if you have both of those, you get the response. How do you know when you're being effective? By how it sounds. So then you also have to have the ability to hear and assess what's going on in front of you. And what the players will tell you very often is that the conductors who are most effective are the ones with the best ears. Because if you don't hear it's wrong, you can't make it right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a huge part of it. And part of conductor training is developing not only the gestural skills and the physical language and the verbal language, how to communicate, but also how do you listen to the orchestra? How do you hear harmonies, chords, instrumental balance, and that sort of thing.
Do you have rehearsals, like for this large orchestra, where you juggle around the positions of people a little so they can better hear?
Yeah, it's an interesting thing because most orchestras have a way that they are set up, and they don't like to change that too much because while the guest conductor might come in and out and be there for 3 or 4 days and rehearse and give a concert, the musicians are playing day in, day out, week after week, and they get accustomed, and they want to sit in the same place because they know how to deal with that setup. They don't want to move it around too much. So you might do some slight adjustments within that setup. I'm doing Mahler Symphony No. 6 right now. I'm rehearsing it for a concert on March 29th with the university orchestra. And I've moved the bass clarinet, which normally sits to my left with all the other clarinets, over by the bassoons, sitting next to the contrabassoon. And a conductor who was watching said to me, "Why'd you do that? I've never seen a bass clarinet sit over there." Well, Mahler Symphony No. 6, very different from all of his other pieces and any other piece that I know, the bass clarinet never plays with the clarinets. It only plays with the bassoons. It doubles the bassoon line all the time. It's occasionally independent, but it never actually plays with the other clarinets. So I decided, let's put them next to the contrabassoon and the bassoons, because that's the little group that plays together all the time. But that's an unusual circumstance. Yeah. There are some pieces that specify, you know, we're talking about Mahler today, but there are a number of pieces that specify instruments to be played off stage, or in the balcony, or in the next room, or out in the lobby. Things like that. So that's an unusual circumstance. Mahler II calls for quite a bit of that. So then we have a lot of rehearsal time to deal with that, try different things. I usually try to bring those people to a rehearsal without the rest of the orchestra there and get that taken care of so I'm not, you know, using the time of 100 people. Yeah.
Given that what the audience hears and what the conductor hears from the podium are different, how do you deal with that?
Yeah. Well,
do you adjust the sound to be right as you hear it, or as you think the audience hears it, or what?
Now, obviously, the reason we do what we do is for the audience, right? We want this music to be right where they sit. And that is the problem, that there's not a player on the stage who knows how it sounds out in the house while they're playing. And the conductor doesn't know either. So you spend a lot of time with assistants who are out in the house saying, can you hear the harp? How's the balance of the fourth horn with the first horn? Things like that. And after you do that for a while and you've worked with enough halls, you rarely need that kind of help anymore, because you know that if it sounds like this here, it's likely to sound like that out there. So very often, for example, I know that if I have the bassoons playing where they're loud enough for me, probably they're too loud in the audience, because where does a bassoon sound go? It goes up like that. And it doesn't go, it's not directional the way a trumpet is. I mean, so that sound goes up and it goes over my head. So I know if I can hear the bassoon, that's enough. It doesn't have to have to be in such great relief. Same with the tuba, you know? The tuba sound comes up, and of course, bass sound travels largely through the floor. Bass sound travels less through the air and more through the floor, right? And more through physical entities than it does through the air in terms of percentage. So some of that sound comes to us that way, but a lot of that sound goes over my head. And I hear very often in Hill Auditorium, when I hear other orchestras playing, the tuba is very often like it's sitting right in my lap. It's way too loud because the conductor doesn't understand what goes on in that room like that.
Yeah. All right.
It's all an educated guess. Let me just say that.
Sure.
While you're conducting, it's all an educated guess. Yes.
Yeah, related question, I think. Have you ever done any recording? Have you supervised placement of microphones to get the proper perspective in the audience?
Yep. Okay, so I have a lot of recordings. I have a dozen recordings on the market now, current recordings.
Well, they would be ones where you were a recording engineer, not a conductor.
No, I'm not a recording engineer, and I don't know anything about it. I know enough about it to say when I go to the booth during a session and the recording engineer says, what do you think? Because here's the way a session usually starts, with playing two or three soft places, two or three loud places, two or three places with the woodwinds alone, brass alone, strings alone, and then I go up to the booth and I listen to the playbacks of all of that and we have a conversation. And I can say, well, you know, there are too many highs, or I can say there are too many lows, or there's not enough presence in the room. And they have, they have mics out in the room to give the ambience, right? Mm-hmm. And so they can either have, bring that up or down, or move it closer or farther, and all of that sort of thing. So we play around with mic placement. Sometimes it's 15 minutes of doing that, sometimes it's 2 or 3 hours. Playing around, especially when recording, something like an opera where you want to have a sort of spatial representation of singers in different places on the stage and so forth. So that can take quite a while. But that's the advantage of having a great producer and a great recording engineer. And we work together, we each bring something different to it, and we come out with something at the end. The latest recording that came out with the University Orchestra, which is thankfully doing very, very well, it's a piece by Evan Chambers called The Old Burying Ground. It's for three singers, soprano, tenor, folk singer, and orchestra. And our producer just won the Grammy for Best Producer of the Year for that. And his first Grammy was also for my first recording, 10 or 11 years ago, actually. And he really knows what he's doing in a big way. His father was the producer of quite a few of Leonard Bernstein's recordings with the New York Philharmonic, and he was raised in it. We have a recording engineering program at the University of Michigan also.
Well, in this booth, how many channels are recorded? How many separate channels?
You got me.
Okay.
There's a lot of them.
Well, we allow you to mix down and turn down certain offending instruments.
Right.
So
well, that's a serious problem for us. So I was in New York for a week last time of 12-hour days trying to remix this recording that just came out recently, and there were a lot of problems with it. So, for example, I say the trombones are too loud here in this part. We need to take them down. Well, we can't take them down because they're actually in the viola microphone. The violas sit in front of the trombone, so the engineer, he got too much trombone sound in the viola thing. So, in order to take down the trombones, the violas disappear completely. So there's a lot of, there are a lot of sacrifices and compromises made, unfortunately. You know, the way they used to do this is they would isolate all the instruments of the orchestra. They'd have their, have little booths that they'd all sit in. Everybody would have headphones on, and they would, and they could just turn everything up and down. But that's so far away from the from a live performance, the way we communicate with each other, that doesn't work.
So to summarize, your orchestra has microphones on a per section basis. It's not
during the recording.
Yeah, for recording. You know, obviously, you guys, when you're live, you're live.
Yeah.
But when you're recording, you are using a lot of microphones at the rate of one or two per instrumental section.
In the most recent recordings that I've done, the last several, there are usually four or five microphones right in front of me. They're around the podium, so they hear what I hear in a way, okay? Although they're higher up. Some of them might be around my ear or head level, face level, and some of them are high up, and they're this way around the podium in front of me. I conduct through this sort of jail of microphones. And then the strings have coverage, and the woodwinds have coverage, and rarely do the brass have it, but occasionally they do. Depends on, I guess, on the recording engineer and what they want to do with it. And then there are microphones out in the house, as I said, and in Hill Auditorium, they can be way up in the balcony as well as in the middle of the first floor.
So there are microphones also for the woodwinds?
Yeah.
Everything but the brass?
Well, I think that there are times when there is something. There's a microphone for low brass, a microphone for the trumpets, a microphone for the horns, but it's more psychological than anything else. They're rarely on. So I need a microphone. Come on, I'm going to be around the corner. Okay, you get a microphone.
Yeah, well, I engage in a very odd art of miking a small orchestra. And one of the purposes that we try to accomplish is our orchestra is wildly unbalanced in terms of instrumentation. Mm-hmm. We try to kind of bring that into space, but I'm kind of smiling because we don't mic the brass either.
Yeah. What kind of orchestra is it?
It's a real small orchestra in a church. Uh-huh. A couple, you know, up to four string players, thinking here, maybe five brass players, four woodwind players, some percussion, of course, some electronic instruments, and bringing that all into something that sounds blended is pretty non-trivial. And everything you talked about, like the problem of leakage, you know, my string mics pick up tremendous amounts of brass.
Sure.
You need a conductor.
There used to be.
You need a conductor.
we have a director, but you know we have a fixed geography. You know, we got to fit between the platform and the pews.
Sure.
And you know it's very real world. I understand that what we do is a lot like what happens at like a Broadway show or something, where they use a wildly unbalanced orchestra and make up the difference electronically.
Yeah, although there's a certain problem with making it up electronically in that. What gives a string section the sound of a string section is that you have human beings playing. If you take one instrument and you amplify it, it sounds like one instrument amplified. In order for it to sound like 16 first violins playing, you'd have to make 16 copies of that and play them slightly apart from one another because it's humanly impossible to
play. Well, you're talking about a level of refinement that we don't even dream about.
Yeah, but that's what makes the string section sound the way it does.
Yeah, they get that machine from all those little delays. And of course, the humans are also not perfectly in sync, but they're really...
And not perfectly in tune. And all those fingers are vibrating at different speeds and creating different... Mm-hmm. Putting out different harmonics, different overtones from the instrument, and that's what makes it sound like that. There is a machine that you can get, by the way, that will, if you run, I don't know what it's called anymore, but...
It's called a digital effects box, and in fact, we often have a problem.
Yeah.
It's kind of known in the recording, small group recording trade, that two violins sound far worse than one.
Well, right. We never use two violins in music,
right.
Or
and
any,
so,
any
know,
high viola or two.
As luck would have it, I have two violinists.
Yeah.
So I have a digital console and I have an effects box, and there's a little effect called chorus, and we use chorus to kind of be a tiebreaker for the two violinists.
Oh, there you go. I thought maybe you were just amplifying them, but you're way more sophisticated than that.
Well, it's meatball surgery. I appreciate what you do very much, and I also appreciate the resources you have.
Did you want to make a phone call?
Thank you. Yeah, but we don't have to. I can do it.
Right. Okay, you know, one of the things that I wanted to do was play some...
Okay.
What?
You were looking for that.
Yeah, no, actually, I'm looking for my crib sheet as to which... No, not this. I have another crib sheet for what's on my recording. And so I would just like to... A couple of samples. This is a combination, show off the hi-fi system and discuss conducting a little bit. Maestro Kiesler and I talked a little bit about Mahler second. I wanted to have all the music be Mahler second, which is what we played and which is what you guys heard. And we're going to start, if everything works right, with just the opening to first movement. You want to just tell them a little bit about what it's all about before we play?
Sure. Well, the first movement was actually originally a piece unto itself, not part of a symphony. He wrote it about 8 years earlier. It was called Totenfeier, which means death ritual or death rite. So it's basically a funeral. And it starts out with I should say, the difference between Totenfeier and then what became the first movement of the Second Symphony is that 8 years later, he expanded the orchestration considerably. He went from three of every woodwind, flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, to four and five of each. Went from four horns to seven horns, beefed up the trumpets to six, added a second set of timpani. He also revised the score and added hundreds of instructions, which is a great thing because you can see how much he learned in the 8 years between these two pieces, the same music. It says now, the orchestra always rushes here, don't let them. The orchestra always plays too loud here, don't let them. There's all sorts of instructions for the music, for the conductor. Don't drag. Make sure this line is heard. Don't rush. Constantly don't drag. That's Mahler's Nicht schleppen. That's his favorite thing. It either means don't drag or no suitcases, I'm not sure. But no schlepping. So that's the first movement is basically about a funeral. It starts with the cellos and basses alone, and they play something. And actually, right before that, are you going to play the very beginning?
I would play the very beginning.
The first note of the piece is a tremolo for the upper strings, you know, very fast bow strokes like that. A very striking, grief-stricken kind of moment.
I've got three different versions of this. What I'd like to do is play one and the other, and if you'd like to know which they are, that's fine. If you want to hear them blindly, that's
fine. Blind is fun.
Okay, good. So here's the first one, if it works. What have you made me okay.
You gonna play all three before I respond?
Yeah, I'll play at least the second one.
Okay.
Often when you conduct, you have people's cell phones crank off, even though you're playing. Told
so with any kind of luck, here's the...
Here, just wait 1 second, there was a question.
I'm sorry.
Oh, it's just not that important.
No, but
the phone rang, I was thinking, you know, always in a concert, they turn your cell phone off.
Yeah, the worst one time is when they go off in the orchestra. So performance, Brahms wrote one triangle part in all of his music. It's in the fourth symphony and the third movement. And right at the moment when the triangle came in the back of the orchestra, the oboist cell phone rings with the old-fashioned kind of ring. Sounds a little like a triangle. I thought, that's the oddest sounding triangle. And then, of course, it was kind of rhythmic and it kept happening. So why you need a cell phone on the stage during a concert, I don't know.
Here's number two.
It's in pause. Comment just on these last two?
Sure. Do you have another one?
Yeah, I have one.
Is that too much? Or do you have
no, that's fine. Well, just for that. Three versions. What do you think?
So everybody could hear the difference, I'm sure. The first, although you may not know the piece, some of you do and some of you don't, I suppose. The first one, so they improved through the three, I'll say. My preferred one is the third one.
Okay.
Okay. The first one, the articulation of the instruments is very flabby. They don't play together, and it's out of tune. And did you notice when the second one started, the pitch was higher than the first one? Slightly sharper than the beginning of the first one. And then so was the playing. The playing of the second one is a little bit more articulated, a little clearer, a little bit better together, still not totally there. While the first one was flabby in its articulation and clarity and ensemble togetherness, the second one is kind of flabby musically. It doesn't have the musical line that I want from it. It kind of sits on every note and doesn't go anywhere. Okay. The third one is articulated. It's together. It follows the composer's instructions. The beginning does not, on that first note, does not say suddenly softer. It has a gradual diminuendo. That's the only one that did just that one measure that gradually gets softer instead of suddenly. Mm-hmm. The string players are playing at the beginning of everything together. Starting with the bow on the string. If you have 60 string players playing, in this case you have 30 because you don't have the violins playing that music, meaning viola, cello, bass, or cello and bass. Anyway, if you have them all start from the air and go like that to start playing, they're never going to be exactly together. They're going to be more together to start with if they start from the string together, because they're already there. They've already made contact. All right, so that's the way they're playing the third one. I think the third one is musically, in terms of the recording engineering, and technically, the far superior to the others.
Okay, very good. You guys have a comment about what you heard?
Yeah. Well, you mentioned about the bow. Now, do you instruct your violinist?
Absolutely.
I've heard that instruction from Maestro Kiesler 43 times.
Do you
at least
instruct a lot start of the musicians the on the use of their instruments?
The idea, our mission is to make it better. So if I stand in front of the Detroit Symphony, which I'm doing again a week from tomorrow, an all Beethoven concert, I'm not going to give the same kind of instruction as I'm going to give in front of, say, a youth orchestra that I'm going to go to. Or an orchestra, if I'm doing German music in Germany, That's one thing. But if I do, and I was just in Leipzig 2 weeks ago, if you do American music over there, like Appalachian Spring of Copeland, I'm going to do a lot of teaching because they don't have a clue. Mm-hmm. All right? An experienced orchestra and an excellent ensemble, you know, ones that are very high level, they will have a clue and they'll know how to do it. But so basically you go in and you assess not only the acoustic, but who are these musicians? How sophisticated are they? How well do they play together? To me, it's never a comment about the musicians if they don't play well. It's a comment about their conductor, their regular conductor. How well are they trained? What is the discipline of this group? What can they do and what they can't do? You want to tell us who's performing?
Let's just do a couple more in there. Okay.
Are they in the same order?
Same order. Okay. Yeah, you wanted the heavenly part in movement one.
So this one kind of describes. It's kind of a heavy.
You're right in front of my. If you can.
Quite a few of Mahler's pieces refer to. They describe a kind of, what musicologists call kind of a heavenly vision or something with. Ascending music, quiet music, and harps and things like that. Can I point out something before you play this?
Please.
In this spot, it's a challenge for the conductor because it says from the minute this music starts, several times in the score, first of all, the instruction in German says gradually holding back tempo. So in other words, you're gradually getting slower. Okay? On the next page, it says continue to get slower. The next page, continue to get slower. Keep holding back. Next page, get slower. Keep holding back. Don't rush. Hold back. Page after page of it. Well, you're going to grind to a halt. You just can't keep doing it. So conductors figure out what to do about it. So one thing they do is very often is you get slower and slower and then find a good place where you might not realize it and then crank the tempo up again and get slower again like that. It's kind of like walking down the railroad tracks. You know, you get to a point, you keep going like that, sort of. All right? Yeah, well, I feel the same way about these excerpts as the first three. The third performance is, to me, vastly superior to the others. And it's not just the sound. It sounds better. It's better together. But it's also, to use the broadest term, more musical. I mean, basically, when you have, anytime you have two notes together, two, three, four, one after another, you have choices to make. It's a little bit like an actor deciding how to declaim or how to say a line in, or a poetry reading. How are you going to say it? And the conductor has a lot to do with how that line is shaped. Is the emphasis, are you going one, two, three, four? Or one, two, three, four, for example? Are you going to the highest note in the phrase as allowed, kind of like an arch? Or are you going away from that, and that sort of thing? So to me, the third one has, I identify more with the performance, the way it's shaped. Mm-hmm. The English horn playing, the last instrument that came in just before you stopped it, the little solo there, that's English horn, which is, it's like an oboe, it's a double reed instrument like an oboe, if you're not familiar with it, except it sounds five whole steps lower than the oboe. It's a little bit longer than an oboe. The second performance, that sounds like a need of rehearsal, it's very sharp and not very legato, not very smooth, doesn't sound very good. The first one is that woofy kind of unfocused sound, and again the third one sounds better to me.
Okay. I unfortunately have a crib sheet that I've got 26 tracks on this thing, and I was going to pick out a couple of others that I wanted to before I gave it away, but I can't, but I've lost my crib sheet. So
you're not sure which is which?
No. I know the first six. I know exactly. I mean, there are 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. I've gone through eight. So it's 8 times 3 is 24. So
is this 24. Something really loud, full orchestra?
That's what I'm trying to find. Exactly. Precisely what I'm trying to find. And I can't find the piece of paper I was sure I had here, laying on this piano earlier.
Behind the piano?
Well, I don't think so.
Just go to the next excerpt.
I don't think. No, the next section will be, wait a minute, the next section will be beginning of movement 2, that's slow.
Yeah.
The next section will be the beginning of movement 3, that might be noisy.
No. Just a little.
Okay.
Three timpani strokes.
Then the next one, and the really good one, is a transition from movement 4 to 5.
Yeah.
Right, so that would be, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
5 is the loudest moment, I would say.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
7, 8.
So 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So 13 is what I want, right? So let's try 13. Let's try 13. See if that's what gets us what we want.
Is this going to be the fourth moment or the fifth?
It'll be the end of the fourth.
Because then it's going to get really low.
Yeah. So there's about 1 minute of this.
Thank you.
You know, I think that part of what we're hearing here is that the third, the engineering on the third one is so much so superior, yeah, in my view, that, you know, to hear the performance is difficult in the first one, actually. Mm-hmm. To just to hear it through the, I don't know what you want to call it, sort of cloudy or muddy kind of texture. Mm-hmm. That's how I feel about it. Mm-hmm. The first one is getting to be annoying to me. Kind of.
Which one?
The first one. First every time. Kind of pedantic, and the tempo is ridiculously slow. The singer has to take breaths where the singer shouldn't have to breathe. She has trouble singing in tune at the end because the tempo is so slow. That word Leben is a very hard one to sing because it starts with an L. And if you have an American, you know, Americans say L in the back, and Germans say L in the front. Lie, right up here, Leben. If you have an E vowel after it, so Leben, right? Leben. If you do it, for instance, in American, it gets under pitch. Leben, all down low, right? The first one has a little bit of an American L at the beginning, and she comes up to it from the bottom, rather than approaching the pitch from the top. I mean, you know that you can talk quite a bit about many things here. The intonation within the orchestra. It says in the beginning of the fifth movement, it starts out with that C major scale in the basses and cellos, and then it says accelerate. It says più mosso, which means more motion right away in Italian, faster. Then it says accelerate, exclamation mark. The first one of the early ones, had hardly any acceleration at all. The last one does it exactly where it's written. He follows the score, he or she, I suppose, follows the score very exactly, which I appreciate. Mm. I mean, when you have somebody like Muller was, he was a conductor. He was the only conductor ever to be music director of the Metropolitan Opera and the New York Philharmonic at the same time. Right. He composed his symphonies in the summer during his breaks from conducting. He mostly conducted in Vienna Opera as well. And he really knew what he was doing. So as a conductor, maybe one of the greatest conductors who ever lived. And that's why his music is successful to a certain degree, because he's able to say, he knows exactly what's going on in the orchestra and he can write in a way that makes it sound terrific. So why ignore those directions? He gives us so many directions, and it's difficult to follow them because there's so many. What musicians are trained to do is to play like the musician next to them, to match sounds. But Mahler will write four trumpet parts, and one of them will have an accent that looks like this, which is kind of a longer accent. Another will have an accent that looks like that, which is a harder, shorter one. Mm-hmm. One will have a line over it, which means play it long. One will be marked piano or pianissimo for really soft. The one next to that person will be marked mezzo forte, and the next one fortissimo. Mm-hmm. One will be getting softer while the other one has a crescendo indication. And he's mixing and matching all of these colors. It's a little bit sometimes like a peacock feather or a hologram or something, the way the colors are changing. In the sixth symphony that I'm working on now, he has a completely different language from the music before it, orchestrational language. So, for example, you have trumpets and oboes playing together, same notes. First trumpet's playing the same note as the first oboe, second trumpet, second oboe, third trumpet, third oboe. So they're playing exactly the same thing. But the trumpets start loud and get soft, and the oboes start soft and get loud. So you're hearing the same music, but the color changes, the tone color changes. It's the same chord, but it changes. It's magical, the way he's able to do that. So when a conductor doesn't follow Mahler's directions, that seems stupid to me, because, mm-hmm, you know, the greatness lies in the music, and if you ignore that, then, you know, especially, see, what upsets me is that I consider that arrogance on the part of the conductor. If you get on the podium and you're not the advocate for the composer, whom are you advocating? Yourself, right? And so that's where I draw the line. The composer writes don't drag, and the conductor slows down. I don't have any use for that conductor. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, I have a feeling about who this first one might be. and there's a little story. There's going to be a story about that.
Okay.
Question. In the second one, after the fifth comes in with this power, yep, and there was a held note of a pair of instruments, and I heard a beat against each other in a, yep, twitter. Somebody was off key way back.
That's right.
Apparently.
Piccolo. See, the piccolo playing up high, that's one thing. I have a lot of trouble myself tuning. I have a lot of trouble. When the piccolo's playing high and it's out of tune, it's like, whatever. You know, I have to depend on the piccolo player to fix it probably 30 or 40% of the time because it's a very hard thing to hear.
Why wouldn't the conductor make sure they redid it and edit and put out a good recording?
Time and money. Mm-hmm. It's always time and money. This recording, that my most recent recording, we finished. The only part of the piece that doesn't have singers in it is the introduction. It's about 2 minutes, 2 or 3 minutes of orchestra alone. So of course we recorded everything that had all the singers first, and we ran out of time. We were at the closing time. We were at the final, you know, at the bell, right? And we hadn't recorded the introduction. I'm just giving you an example. So then you beg with the orchestra, can we just have 15 more minutes? Can we have 10 more minutes? Let's just, sure, everybody says, sure, let's, you know, we've got to do it, so let's do it. So we had only time to play through the first, through the introduction once, make 2 or 3 comments, and play it through again. No patches, no cleaning up anything, that's all. So what I tell people when they listen to that recording is just, you know, maybe be reading or doing something else during the listen to that part in your car.
Well, speaking of time and money and the Detroit Symphony's problems, I mean, any comments you'd have on that? Is there...
Well, can we hear the orchestras were in this first?
Oh, so you want to hear the which ones?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'd be happy to come in on that.
Okay. Yeah. So remember, hold that question. Right?
Yeah.
Okay, decode. Number 1, Slatkin. Number 2, Abado in Chicago. Mm-hmm. Number 3, Järvi.
Ah, Järvi, and with whom?
With a mixed group in the cathedral in New York.
And who recorded it? I mean, or what label is it on?
You know, I don't know. It's on a DVD.
It's on a DVD. Right?
It's on a DVD. Oh. So I had to rip the DVD, and one of the problems was that all three were recorded at grossly different levels. So in order to make them even close to similar, I had to edit the tracks a little bit to try and...
Sure.
So I wasn't fully successful, but I didn't spend a whole lot of time.
Well, this is a little bit politically charged now that you have Järvi and Slatkin in the
yes.
same
yes.
Slatkin and what orchestra? Slatkin and who?
St. Louis.
Slatkin and...
St. Louis.
Was it St. Louis? Okay.
Yeah. And Kathy Battle and...
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Yeah. Well...
Was that on a Vox box?
I stand by what I said.
Vox box? You made a lot of Vox boxes when the CD first hit.
No. The first two. Yeah. The first one was I ripped it off of my CD that I had.
It's Telarc, isn't it?
It's Telarc, exactly. Oh, okay. The second one I actually downloaded from iTunes, so it's an MP4. So the second one was actually compressed, but okay. Yeah. And the third one I ripped off of a DVD.
Yeah, well, there are several Abado recordings, and musically, I mean, he's taught me a lot of lessons mm-hmm. about Mahler. If you listen to Chicago, quite frequently, we would record a symphony with Schulte, and then a month or two later or a month or two before, they'd do the same symphony in the same space, the same orchestra with Abado. And it's a real lesson in the difference in the approach of conductors. Mm. Abado tends to be warmer, more talented, singing and lyrical and human, you know. But I think the Järvi recording is spectacular, actually, from what I just heard. But there's a lot more music to hear,
sure.
You know, and the overall affect or effect could be different by listening to the entire thing, you know. The Slatkin recording is the Slatkin recording. What can I say about it?
Falls into my question about the DSO.
Well, okay, so, the DSO is a complicated situation. I'm sure that there are arguments on both sides. It happens that I'm a musician, so I'm conducting the orchestra during the strike. This is the second time they've asked me to do a few things. There are conductors who refused to do that, and there are conductors who said they would do it and then canceled under pressure the day before or 2 days before. I think that the way the musicians are being treated is regrettable at best. On the other hand, every arts institution faces what every other institution faces right now, which is the economic environment. And an arts institution in Detroit faces a particularly difficult environment. The management made some mistakes in terms of investment in the building and over-investing and overspending and so forth. And there's probably responsibility or accountability to be had on both sides. You know, what happened with the musicians many years ago, the musicians union wanted to build employment for their musicians. And so we went from an orchestra that played 20 weeks a year or 30 weeks a year to full employment, 52 weeks seasons. That meant that management has to come up with enough work, enough kinds of concerts to bring in the audiences more and more often. And that is a difficult thing to do. So there's some historical context, you know, that created this whole environment of orchestras that work 52 weeks a year. And is that something that's good for the art? Or is it only good for employment? And so I think that there's, anyway, right now, in this situation, I have to stand with the musicians. I mean, this is a very sad situation. The orchestra had, 96 or 100 or something like that full-time players. There are only 80 left.
Oh.
The four percussionists who played in the orchestra were considered by many people to be among the very finest percussionists in the country. Mm-hmm. And to give you an idea how fine they are, the principal percussionist of the Detroit Symphony has now left because he just won the principal job in Cleveland Orchestra. The timpanist won the principal timpani job in Dallas. I can't remember now where the third one went to another big orchestra.
Boston.
I can't remember. Boston Symphony.
Boston. Right. Boston.
And the fourth one is just freelancing. He's moving to St. Paul or something. Yeah. So that's just one example of how sad this is, that you can't replace these kind of people. And to maintain the quality of the orchestra in the future, first, people are leaving, and then to attract who's going to come and take this job in the future, what kinds of people are going to audition for it. On the other hand, there is one thing that the management is trying to do, and I have to say, I don't know. The musicians, I don't know a lot about this, because the musicians have really honored their commitment to keep what's going on in the negotiation rooms quiet. They don't talk about it. But it's public knowledge that the management wants the musicians to... They want to redefine employment from simply playing, rehearsing and performing, to include teaching, going in the community, community engagement, and that sort of thing, which has in the past been voluntary on the part of the musicians, when the management asks, would anybody like to go in a school or something like that? But they want to make that not voluntary, even to the point where there's been talk about the management collecting money for private lessons. Violin lessons or viola lessons, and then dispersing that money to players who are then responsible for doing a certain number of lessons. You know, so yeah. Well, we'll see what happens. I think the musicians suggested binding arbitration. Management rejected that, and I don't know what's going to happen.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question going back to the wonderful performance at the auditorium you conducted.
Yeah.
The catwalks that have been apparently added to the stage, I don't remember them. I was a student at U of M.
They were not there before.
65 to 69. Mm-hmm. That was a nice touch. Did Mahler make an allowance to have some of your brass instruments go way wide like that?
Well, he says removed from the stage.
Uh-huh.
So where exactly they go is a question. And sometimes he uses the expression not removed from the stage, and other times he'll say in the wings.
Okay.
But it's hard to know where that...
It made a nice touch. I seem to remember a trombone solo where I couldn't see the trombone, and I was right in the middle, right behind you in that first section. Mm-hmm. Kurt and I were sitting, and Kurt's wife and I were all sitting right there. Was that done behind a... some kind of a privacy curtain or something? I just...
Well, in Muller's second, the offstage parts are horns, French horns.
Okay, and the notes were quite low, I don't remember.
Yeah, so they're low, but they're French horns.
Ah.
And they play, Muller says in the score, as many horns as possible. But most, vast majority of time, four people play offstage. There are six onstage horn parts.
This was, these were not on the catwalks at the time I heard the notes.
No, they were off in the loading dock, and they were watching on a video camera. And what we do is we modulate, or we affect a change in the tone quality and the volume by having an assistant conductor. You have the door closed the first time they play, and then they sound a little closer. He opens the door, and so on.
Well, you're a sound engineer. Yeah. You have engine. The sound was fantastic. Kurt, don't you agree? Right where we were. No way I could think of a home stereo that would ever produce that space and that.
Well, let me tell you about a performance I did of Mahler's Second just before that one, or a few months before that. It was in the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in New York.
Whoa.
It's the largest church in the world.
Yep.
And behind the orchestra and the chorus, I mean, you have a huge audience there, and behind the orchestra and chorus, there's another about 300 feet behind them, to the end of the church, to the back of the church. And I had, I had eight horns off stage, and they were way off in the back, with a 13-second delay.
Oh.
So it's 8 seconds before the sound is audibly fading, right? And 13 seconds until it stops. So this is the strangest thing, to go like this. This is the way it was. Boom, boom. But what's really strange is to look at the players, because they take the instruments off their mouths and put them by their side. The instrument sounds like it's still playing. Now, I've performed at St. Mark, San Marco in Venice, and at the Vatican, and in big churches, you know, as part of my profession for years, you know.
Well,
but nothing like this. This is quite extraordinary.
At St. John, did you get a chance to talk to the staff of the church?
Yeah.
Rumor has it that the pipe organ was badly damaged, maybe some kind of a fire or something.
Don't know about that. Recently?
And that is it all rebuilt now?
Well, we used the organ, but the organ was a problem because, according to the tuner on my iPhone, it was 13 cents flat.
Yeah. Whoa.
So that's 13% of a semitone flat. Right? And that was a problem because the organ comes in a big chord at the end. Mm-hmm. And we decided we're not going to sacrifice the whole performance for that. The organ's just going to have to sound flat, because you can't do 80 minutes of music in the where all the musicians are struggling to play their instruments that low. But what a performance that was. This performance here, I've done Muller Second at Hill three times, twice with university orchestras, you know, maybe 5 years ago, and again maybe a year ago. But this one was remarkable to me because the LSO is made up of amateur musicians, people who do something else. And what a powerful and moving experience it was to... what an achievement for all of us.
Well,
that day.
You know,
quite remarkable.
I have to say, for me, it's the thrill of a lifetime. The absolute pinnacle of my musical career, such as it is. I've loved the Second for 50 years, and actually have played in it, and it didn't come off too badly, and I attribute that all to Maestro Kiesler here. The way he led and guided us through this thing, I was, frankly, while playing it, there were times I couldn't play because there were tears in my eyes. I couldn't see the music.
That's why it was difficult to listen to, because there were tears in my eyes.
It's an incredible piece.
A couple of questions.
Yeah.
How much of the faults in some of those recordings are likely to be lack of rehearsal time? I heard a lot of talk about that from a friend of mine who knows people in the symphony.
I would say that these recordings, that it's probably not an issue. Because these orchestras don't record something unless they've performed it a few times before. And also, this kind of piece is in the repertoire of an orchestra like that. As opposed to an amateur orchestra, say, is going to do this every 10 years. They might play it every 2 years or every 3 years, and they play other Mahler symphonies. And they play together every week other music. So. I wouldn't attribute too much of it to that. Maybe recording time, it's possible that less recording time, but it's also just the approach of the conductors, I think.
So it's not a good excuse.
I don't think so. I'm sure that the St. Louis Symphony invested a lot of time in that telec recording back then. Yeah, I mean, this is when the St. Louis Symphony was called by Time magazine the second best orchestra in the country. I mean, they made it from being, they were used to be considered sort of in the 15th or 20th category, mm-hmm. they were starting to talk about the big six, and St. Louis being one of them, and so on. And that was during when Leonard was at was there during these recordings.
And speaking of Telarc, Telarc tried to revive a lot of what Mercury did, minimalist microphoning. What do you think of that type of recording? I do a lot of amateur recording. I record Bern stuff with the Ipsy group. And what I've learned from that is that the room has more to do with the recording than the engineer does. There's not much I can do with two microphones.
Right.
And I'm stuck with whatever the room does with the sound. And I've got some recordings I'm thrilled with and some that are horrible of the same people, just the venue is different.
Sure. I think
seems to be,
and that's why we're grateful to have Hill Auditorium to do recordings. Actually, it's terrific for recordings. And in the renovation of Hill, they put in a very high end recording booth. You know, there's a lot of money invested in the equipment and the microphones alone, but in the equipment there, it might be interesting for you to speak with the people who run that place. No, but I would agree with you. But I think, I mean, the venue and the conductor and the orchestra's comfort level in that venue. That recording, the Yerby recording, was done in New York.
It was done at a cathedral.
Riverside Cathedral. Right. Yeah. So that's a great space to do it. Much better than Cathedral of Saint John the Divine. You'd never want to record in there because it's just it's too muddy.
What do you think of those type recordings? Do you prefer the stuff with the multi-mics and the ability to tweak it, or do you think the other simple stuff has
to be? I've done both, and I see different attributes in each one of them. I like the idea of simple recording where the performance is the performance, and you don't mess with it too much.
I remember when London was recording the Detroit Symphony.
Yeah.
They actually built a platform out from the stage so that they could rearrange the orchestra to suit their simple microphone setup instead of using accent mics.
Yeah, the Boston Symphony records in Symphony Hall, but they don't record on the stage. They go out in the very middle of the hall, and they mic around the orchestra. They don't record.
When I was a student at Cass Tech where they did the Paul Perret recordings, I was in there when it was set up for recording. It was a completely different room. You wouldn't recognize it because we used to joke you could blow a trumpet and come back in 5 minutes and still hear it ring in there.
Yeah.
But they had all kinds of drapes hung and
treated. I performed in there with the Detroit Symphony when I was 20-something. I conducted them in kids' concerts for the students at Cass Tech, and then they bust in some students from other places. So that was the only time I was ever in there.
Imagine you're happy they saved Orchestral Hall compared to the Ford Auditorium.
Quite a difference, huh?
Oh.
It was fun for me to go back to the Detroit Symphony, actually, because you reminded me of Cass Tech, because there was somebody in the orchestra came up to me and said, I remember your last concert with us, and it was 28 years ago. So that was something.
I just want to have another music interlude. Since we mentioned the how about just playing the last minute or minute and a half, 2 minutes of the whole symphony with Yerby?
Sure. This is to hear the system.
Thank you.
It's really different. The ending, I've never heard the ending done like that.
Hmm.
I mean, the tempos are very, very different from anything I've ever heard. Much faster.
Yeah. Much faster.
Much faster than anything I've ever heard before. I mean, where Muller says, move along a little, he really moves along. yeah, it's very exciting.
Hmm.
Very, very exciting. My first exposure to Järvi, I was associate conductor in Indianapolis when I was 22, I think. And he came as a guest conductor, and I was assigned to cover his concert. And he was doing a program of Mozart, post-horn serenade, a brand new double bass concerto by Paul Ramsier, and Shostakovich Symphony No. 6. And the regulations in the contract require most orchestras for the rehearsal schedule to be announced at least a week in advance, sometimes 30 days in advance. You have to say what you're going to rehearse on any given day, so musicians can be prepared for it. And so he announced that he would rehearse the Mozart, and then he would rehearse the Shostakovich, his first rehearsal. And he was pretty new to this country at the time. He came to rehearsal wearing a gray suit and a tie, conducted, which is unusual in rehearsal. And he did the Mozart. And at the end of the Mozart, he said, very good, I'd like to go on to the Shostakovich, but at the end of the rehearsal, we'll come back to the Mozart again. And the union representative said, you can't do that. You said you were going to do Mozart and Shostakovich, so you can't go back. And he said, well, let me just see if I understand this. There are 35 players involved in the Mozart, and now I'm going to go on to the Shostakovich, and I'm going to let all of these other people leave so I can go back to, you know, from 90 players to 35 players, and they'll all be able to leave early so I can work on the Mozart again. And they said, no, you can't do that because you didn't put it you didn't post the rehearsal schedule. So this was the huge lesson that he gave me as a young conductor that day. He said, well, that's fine. I'm going to stick with my plan because it's the best plan. And when I go back to the Mozart, he said, instead of going back to the Mozart at the end, I'll just rehearse it now for the next hour. But I'd like all the Shostakovich people to sit here right during the Mozart rehearsal. This was his first rehearsal with the orchestra ever, and he was so unconcerned with what they thought of him. And he said, that's fine. You all just sit here, you Shostakovich people, and I'll just spend the time right now. And he made 65 or 70 extra players sit there while he rehearsed the Mozart symphony to prove his point that the contract was a stupid thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I don't think that I ever saw the orchestra have more respect for anybody than they did for him after that experience. That
was how much respect did they have for the union? Right?
That was incredible. Well, you know, actually, it's the orchestra themselves. They everything in a contract is a reaction to some violation that happened in the past. You know, there's a clause that says we don't play. The concert has to stop if the temperature rises above 84 degrees. Well, you know, at some point they were playing out in the sun in a park or something, and it was 95 degrees out, or something happened in a hall and there was no air conditioning in the summer, so that makes its way into the contract, and there's good reason. And probably some conductor decided to rehearse a piece that required English horn and bassoon, and they weren't there or something because it wasn't on the schedule or something like that, so now it has to be on the schedule. Eric Kunzel taught me a lesson also at the same time I was talking with him about this, what had happened, and he said he taught me his trick, which I've done ever since. He's the Pops conductor, Cincinnati Pops. He does, those Pops concerts have not three or four pieces, but 12 or 15 pieces. Mm-hmm. He said, well, just put on the rehearsal schedule the whole program, and then put it again, and then put it again. Then you can do whatever you want.
How long has he been gone? He passed away within the last year.
Within the last year or so. I don't know.
70, just over 70. He's a great guy. If I live him once, he's crazy.
Yes, yeah. So I'm sorry, I'm not an engineer. I can't answer some of your questions about that. But anything else about conducting or music? Or should
we? When are your favorite conductors?
My favorite conductors?
And why, I guess?
Well, I was hugely influenced by Carlo Maria Giulini.
Mm-hmm.
I met him and I worked with him for a couple of years off and on. Assisted covered concerts with Santa Cecilia, Orchestra Paris, Philharmonia in London, and spiritually, he is the big influence. In other words, what a conductor's life ought to be, you know? Mm-hmm. He was kind of a priest of music, and he had a huge influence on me musically. I worked with him on music of the symphonies of Brahms, Schumann, and Schubert, and the Verdi Requiem. Mm-hmm. And he also said something to me that this is the 15th year of the summer conducting training program I run in Maine, in the woods. It happens that I'm also a registered Maine guide, and I lead wilderness trips in Maine. And so I've been going to Maine for years. And it's the 15th year of this place called the Conductor's Retreat at Madomic. And what we do there is we spend a lot of time studying music and a lot of time practicing and a lot of time in contemplation or just away from the work. And he said to me, Giulini, he said, if you're going to spend 10 hours conducting a piece, studying a piece, learning a piece, don't spend 10 hours in one day. Spend 10 hours every day for 10 days. Spend the rest of the time walking in the woods. And that idea of like, of sowing the seeds, of contemplating, of letting it sit, of stewing it and thinking it over. I mean, the truth is, right now I'm studying Mahler 6th while I'm talking to you. Because, not consciously, but I've been working on it. And when I come back to it, there'll be new decisions, right? Yeah, so he was a huge influence on me. But I also, people like Norrington and Hogwood and the people who brought us this sort of new look at old music, or an old look at old music, they've had an influence on me as well. And I'm a huge fan of Abbado, it happens that the first recording we heard today, that's consistent with my views on about that particular way of approaching things. And it's a very, very different thing from the Abbado, Muti, Giulini in that world. Simon Rattle, who's a fabulous conductor, who's around today, of course. And Bernstein, huge influence. In fact, the new Bernstein book, I'm proud to say there's this book that just came out around Christmas time. It's a coffee table size book called Leonard Bernstein at Work, The Final Years. And on page 101, there's a full page picture of the two of us. And I'm very, very, in a very touching moment where he was a very big influence.
Have you done any composing?
Not much. No, I really have a huge respect and admiration for composers, because to go from nothing, to have nothing, and create something. I'm dealing with something that's created, and I'm better at doctoring things.
Interpreting, delivering, yeah.
And being the composer's advocate, I can say
that. What is your opinion on this? Your old recording, so the technology is lousy, but yeah. Fritz Reiner, when he had the Chicago Symphony?
Great, absolutely great. Some of the greatest recordings, pictures at an exhibition.
Well, yes.
Some of the most remarkable recordings.
I was introduced to that music by a kid across the hall who had been one of my Cub Scout buddies years ago, who went to the Interlochen Music Academy for high school, so I lost track of him for 4 years, and all of a sudden I hear this classical music when everybody else is playing Beatles, and I go into his room and it's Billy Bernhardt studying the violin at UM School of Music, and he played me some Red Seal LPs on a nice Gerard turntable, albeit little crummy speakers, you know, but still decent enough tracking and all, that it was had clarity, and he told me that one thing he respected in Reiner was that he gave the violinists a chance to really, the soloists especially, to really do their thing. Can you comment on that at all?
I don't know about that particular aspect.
Well, there's a Scheherazade stereo wide recording.
Yeah, I know the recording.
When it was reissued on CD, they didn't even mention the soloist's name.
Yeah, well, that's
so I get out my LP and I made a new liner note by scanning the back of the LP and sticking it with the CD. Yeah, people lose track of these things.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, an orchestra like the Chicago Symphony, or these days San Francisco Symphony, to use another example, the sound is shaped over a period of several conductors, not just from one. Mm-hmm. It's not Michael Tilson Thomas's sound, it's Blomstedt's sound, you know, who came before him. And now it's turning into Michael's sound. It's very different now. Mm-hmm. Over the 8 years ago when they came here and played an Ives Fourth Symphony, and it had the sort of warmth and luster of the Blomstedt sound and the energy and excitement that Michael brings to it, and that warmth and luster is going away, and now there's more of a brilliance to the sound of the orchestra. And I think Reiner certainly contributed in the
you probably
heard
some of the stories about him actually shutting down a rehearsal and sending somebody home.
Firing.
Well, say, you're drunk. We start again tomorrow. That kind
the famous
of
one when he is of Reiner there is when he, is when somebody set up a telescope in the double bass section because he's famous for his very small beat. And then Reiner said, "So what are you doing?" And he said, "Well, I'm using the telescope to see your beat, Maestro." And so Reiner leaned over and he tore a corner off his score and he wrote something. And he said, "Read this. And he said, you're fired."
Yes. When I listen to the Mahler for the second, I have a difficult time not thinking of the Song of the Earth. Do you ever find, when you're doing a piece, that the composer's subsequent development contaminates or influences or changes your interpretation of the previous piece?
Yeah, you have to be careful about that sometimes. I had two teachers, Eric Leinsdorf and Julius Herford, who said to me, "You have no right to," pretty much in the same words, "you have no right to conduct Beethoven ninth until you've conducted 1 through 8. You have no right to do the B minor mass until you've done all the Bach cantatas." You know, that sort of thing. And there is a benefit to, we not only learn a piece, we learn the composer, But that's absolutely right. So when I do Totenfeier, which I'm doing again this summer, and it's 8 years before Mahler second, 8 or 9 years, I have to be very careful not to apply all of his revisions backwards to the original thing. Yeah. It's a snapshot in time of what he created at that time. I'll tell you what happens to me, though, conducting enough Muller or enough Brahms or other composers, is that when I'm working on a piece and I have it in my memory, and I'm in the middle of the first movement of Mahler second, and all of a sudden I'm in the middle of the first movement of Mahler sixth. And then I think, oh gosh, which one is this now? Sort of wander back again, and now I'm in the fifth. Oh dear, because the language is so similar. The most fun, actually, in that way of with those kind of mental things happening, I was doing Beethoven's seventh, this piece that I've been doing since it was my first professional concert when I was 20 or something, 21. With the Portland, Maine Symphony at the time. And I conduct the piece without a score, and I always have. But there's a place in the last movement that is extremely challenging for conductors to remember. It's the way Beethoven was intentionally obfuscating or de-clarifying, whatever the word is, the structure at that moment. So it's very hard to keep track of. But there's music in the second movement, and the first movement is not so hard to keep track of. So my way of doing things is while I'm conducting the second movement, I'm usually practicing the last movement. I'm thinking about that spot in the last movement because you can do that. It seems like that wouldn't be appropriate, but it actually somehow gives you a perspective on where you are at the moment to be in a different, to step away from it a little bit. This has nothing to do with what you're here to talk about. Absolutely nothing.
That's wonderful. With that.
Well, yeah, we've kept you for an hour, more than an hour and a half.
Yeah, I have to call the airline about my phone.
Okay. Any more questions? Well, thank you very much.
Nice to hear your system also.
Well, thank you.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.